Let's all bow our heads this morning. Our God, the Almighty Savior, He's here. He's in our midst. His presence is with us. It's in our midst. Father, we want to thank you, Lord. We want to exalt your name. We want to praise you, Lord. We want to worship and adore you, Father. For you are good. For your mercy endures forever. Your grace to all generations. Thank you, Father, for your presence, for your goodness, for your mercy in our life, Lord. We want to worship, we want to honor you, Father, we want to exalt you. Church, let's use this time to get right with God this morning and glorify him and magnify his name and exalt and praise him and worship and adore him. For he is worthy of all our praises. He's worthy of all the glory. He's worthy of all the honor. Our God is here in our midst. And he's working. This morning, the voice of God wishes to call out to us that he has appointed this time for us to come before him, to exalt him, to adore him. Who is like our God? There is absolutely no one. There is no one like him. Our Lord, we want to praise, we want to thank, we want to worship, we want to adore you, Lord. Glorify and magnify his name. We praise him. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, it is, Lord. We see that the seraphim, they keep saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Church, I don't believe that they were just singing a song, but they were beholding the awesomeness of God every single moment. They're saying, holy, holy, O Lord, you are. Well, the scripture says that the place shook at the voice. I think they were screaming on the top of their lungs and saying, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. This morning, how much more should we be saying for what God has done for us? And so let's say it once again. For your name is holy. And let's just mean it this time. Holy, Lord. For your name is holy. Holy.
Holy, Lord.
Say it till you feel it.
For your name is holy. Holy, Lord.
Let's lift our hands up. It is holy. Holy, Lord. Yes, the name of the Lord is holy. It's magnificent. Our God, we want to thank you, Lord, for this morning. Father, as we are joined here, Father God, we know that there's one thing that we are going to be doing, Lord. We are going to be exalting your name, oh Father. We know, Lord, that your presence is here. In our midst, we know, Lord, that your awesome presence, Father God, is touching each of us, Father. Your awesome presence, of Father God, is moving in our midst, Lord. Your awesome presence, of Father God, is going to do something wonderful this morning, Father God. And we are going to encounter with Jesus. We're going to meet you, Father God, the one true God. Yes, Master. We know, oh Father God, that you are here in our midst, oh Master. We know that you are here, oh Father God, and you're going to work, Father, this morning. Master, your presence, oh Father God, is just enough for us, Lord. Your presence is enough for us, oh Father God. Rikaba, Shiraba, Sandai. Yes, Lord, Master. We pray, Lord, Master God, that this morning we know that this is the appointed time of Father God. This is the appointed time of Father God. And we know that at the appointed time, we're going to meet with you, oh Father God. We're going to meet with you, oh Father, and we are going to, Father, experience your power. We're going to experience your presence. We're going to experience, oh Father God, your wonderful, wonder-working power here in our midst, oh Master. Yes, Lord. We give you the glory this morning, Father. We pray for everyone who's gathered here, Lord. We pray for everyone who's on their way, Lord. We pray for every empty chair as well, Father. We know, Lord, that you have appointed someone for this empty chair, Father God, this morning. We know, Father God, that you have made, Father God, an appointment for someone to be here this morning, Lord, so that they might receive from you exactly what they need in this moment, Lord. Exactly what they need this morning, Lord. Exactly what they need in the midst of their situation, Father God. Everyone has come here with an expectation, Lord. And you are the God who fulfills all expectations. You are the one who fulfills all our needs. As your scripture says, according to your riches in glory, Master. We thank you, Father God. We thank you, Lord. We give you all the glory, Father, this morning. And let your children, Father, be blessed. Let them experience the power of the Holy Spirit moving this morning, O Father God, in our midst, O Master. In our mighty way, O Father God, that each one, Father God, might be able to reach out and touch you, Lord. We give thanks for your presence is here. We give thanks because you were here before we got here, Father God. Do something new this morning, Lord. Give us a new experience, O Father. Give us that experience, O Father God, that draws us nearer to you, Lord. We give thanks. We give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray, and let the church say, amen, amen. Amen. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Yeah, it's so joyful to see you on another Sunday morning. Yeah, Easter Sunday is over last week. Does this mean that the Lord has not risen again? Amen. He rises every minute in our life. Yeah, I want you to tell yourself, just tell yourself, right? Don't worry about your neighbors, whether they believe it or not. Don't worry about them. Just tell yourself, Christ is risen in me this very second.
Christ is risen in me this very second.
He's going to rise again. And he's going to continue rising. Amen. As long as you remember that, as long as you remember that Christ is alive in you and he's rising every moment, you don't need Easter once a year. Every moment, every minute of your life is Easter. I'd like us to go to one scripture. From the second book of Corinthians. Yeah, Paul wrote to the church in Corinth. We'll go to chapter number 11. Yeah. And this morning, before I encourage you, I just want to speak a little bit of truth. Yeah, you all heard that truth is bitter. Yeah, the truth is bitter sometimes. Yeah, depending on where we find ourselves, the truth is bitter sometimes. And we reflected on this scripture passage last evening in the Saturday prayer watch. For those of you who don't know, you know, every Saturday at 7:30 p.m., we meet here in the church and we have a prayer watch. All of you should make it a priority to make it to this prayer watch if you can. Yeah, all of you who have got your leave and all, we absolutely understand that some of you can't make it due to other commitments, but those of you who can make it, you should be here because the presence of God is always going to be here. And not just the Saturday prayer watch, all the other meetings as well. Whichever meetings you can make, just make it because it helps to just strengthen your spirit a little more, right? And how many of you have come to the church in vehicles? Yeah, in your own cars, your own bikes, right? How many times, you know, in 2024, you had to fuel your vehicle, right? Every time the fuel level goes low, you need to go to a fuel station to fuel up your vehicle. So it's necessary. Sometimes our fuel keeps going low. And some of us don't have a big tank that goes for 1 week. Some of our tanks last only 4 hours, I can tell you this. Right? So that's how frequently you need to be in the presence of God. That's how frequently you need to come in and have an interaction with God. So we've got not a meeting every 4 hours, but we've got at least 3 meetings outside of the Sunday meeting that happens during the week. We have our Wednesday Bible study. We have our Friday prayers, intercessory prayer, and then we've got a prayer watch on Saturday. I would encourage all of you to come in and join. Anyways, back to the scripture right now. And I'm reading from verse 1 onwards, And we'll go to, we'll read verse 1 through 4. Okay, now this is Paul writing. He says, I hope you will put up with a little more of my foolishness. So Paul, he's starting by humbling himself and saying, maybe what I'm going to say to you next is going to sound stupid. And probably some of you are feeling that this morning. So I want to also appeal to you the same way. Maybe you can put up with my foolishness for a little more while, right? Please bear with me. Yeah, and this is my appeal as well. As Paul appeals to the Corinthians, please bear with me, right? For I am jealous for you with the jealousy of God himself. I promised you as a pure bride to one husband, Christ. Okay, just take this in for a minute. Yesterday we reflected in the evening on the church being the bride of Christ. And what are the attributes of being a bride? And we started with the question, who are you in Christ? And we came to a conclusion. It starts with being a new creation the moment you accept Christ. But then it transforms, it moves into becoming a bride for Christ. Waiting expectantly for Christ to come back and take us. Not only expectantly, but also exclusively. Yeah, and that's what Paul is saying here. I'm jealous for you with the jealousy of God himself. I promised you as a pure bride to one husband, Christ. By virtue of this, all of us are adulterers. Take that in for a moment. That's the truth. Me included. By virtue of this, all of us are adulterers. Because there have been many other things in addition to God in our life. Yeah. That's the standard of life that we live today. There's been many other things. You might say, oh God, come here and be the holiest person. Lift your hand the highest, jump the highest, sing the loudest, pray in tongues. But amidst all of this, our life sometimes is a double standard, more often than not. Yeah. But I fear, verse number 3, but I fear that somehow your pure and undivided devotion to Christ will be corrupted, just as Eve was deceived by the cunning ways of the serpent. The Garden of Eden is a scene that all of us know. God said, you can eat of any fruit in the garden except this one. He didn't even put a hedge of protection around the tree of life. You know, can you imagine? I sometimes think about it and I marvel. When you go to Genesis and read through the scriptures, and I want to encourage you to read through that scripture. Before they ate from this tree of good and bad, or knowledge of good and evil, the scripture doesn't record that they ate from the tree of life. And only after they committed the sin, it says that God put a hedge around the tree of life so that they don't go and eat from that as well. Which means, until that point, the tree of life was accessible for them. They could have chose life. Instead, they chose death. Yeah. And some of you might be confused this morning, so I want to just clarify a little what the Holy Spirit has taught me about this. Satan came and deceived Eve and said, did God say that you will surely die? But I'll tell you, you won't surely die. Right? And they ate the fruit. Did they die? They didn't die. Is there a controversy there? Is God a liar? God said they will surely die, but they didn't die. What happened there? A death happened there. They were spirit beings before that. And in spirit beings, they saw everything that was spiritual in nature. The moment they ate the fruit, and God was referring to two kinds of death when he said you will surely die. One, your spirit will die immediately. Second, your body will eventually die. Man was not created to die, let me tell you this. In God's original plan, man was not going to die. But death entered the world. For Methuselah, after 969 years, for some of us, after 60, 70, 80 years. Because of that sin. So God was not lying. But the spirit in them died immediately. And that's where the scripture says their eyes were open and they saw that they were naked. Till then, were they blind? No. They were viewing everything through their spiritual eyes. And that's why nakedness was not a thing. Because nakedness was a thing of the physical world, not the spiritual world. The spirit was beyond the body. The spirit was beyond everything physical that we see. But when the spirit died, the only thing that was living there was the body. And that's when they started to feel their nakedness. So, in our lives as well, God sometimes gives us a warning. This is wrong. We shouldn't be doing this. We should move away from that. But just like Eve, we tend to do something and say, it's okay. The grace of God is there. I'll tell you, the grace of God is the most misinterpreted concept in the churches today. We use the grace of God as a license to sin, as a license to continue to live the life that we are living. Yeah, if you have a doubt, just go and read Romans 15, and that'll tell you the whole thing. Right? It talks about the grace of God, and it tells us what the grace of God did for us and why we shouldn't take that for granted. You know what? The climax of this verse is verse number 4 of this scripture passage. Is verse number 4. Thank you, David. I was getting a lot of bass there. Yeah. You happily put up with whatever anyone tells you, even if they preach a different Jesus than the one we preach. Wow. Take that in for a minute. You happily put up with what anyone tells you, with whatever anyone tells you, even if they preach a different Jesus. I think the world is full of preachers today. Which ones are you listening to? What is the Jesus that they preach? Is it different to the one that you first heard? If you heard the right one in the first place. And we have another, we have three versions of Jesus. Yeah? One is the true Jesus. Unadulterated. True Jesus. The second is others' interpretation of Jesus, which is not the true Jesus. And the third is a Jesus which I think I'd like to call my Jesus. I have made up that Jesus in my mind. Oh, with my Jesus, this is not wrong. My Jesus will be acceptable of this. My Jesus will be more polite. My Jesus will be more, my Jesus will not judge. Well, I'll tell you, that's not your Jesus. That's not Jesus at all. That's just you in an elevated form. If there is a single verse in the scripture that doesn't line up with what we are doing, don't tear that scripture out. Change yourself. This is what God taught me, right? I don't agree with this scripture. Well, change yourself. If you don't agree with the scripture, change yourself. And I want to encourage us from this passage this morning. As Paul, and what struck me yesterday when Pastor was telling this is, Corinth was considered as that church which was filled with the spiritual gifts. Everyone had spiritual gifts. They could speak in tongues. They could prophesy. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. That is the church to which Paul is writing this. How much more relevant is it to you and me, my dear brother and sister, this morning? With that, a little bit of bitter truth, I'd like to add some sweetness here. This is amazing grace that you and I, despite all of these things, can come here and say, Lord, I'm so sorry. I want to change. I want to be a new creation. Not just that, I want to proceed to be the bride of Christ. With that attitude, let's go into this praise and worship this morning. Don't feel bad that the truth challenged you where you are. Because if it did challenge you, there is a God-given guilty conscience in you which is at work. Be happy. The day you need to be worried is when that guilty conscience doesn't work. When you don't feel bad, when the scriptures don't cut through your heart, that's when you need to feel bad, because there, something is wrong. Something is wrong. When the scripture cuts through your heart, thank you, Lord. My guilty conscience, the Holy Spirit in me, is still alive and is still pointing me to Jesus. We're going to sing This Is Amazing Grace. As you sing This Is Amazing Grace, use this as an opportunity to ask God for forgiveness and recommit your life to God once again. I wanted to spend this time because more often than not, we make worship a few songs. We make it a few songs. Worship is not a few songs. Worship is a way of life. And the songs are just there as an atmosphere to help us to connect to God. And let's truly do that this morning and glorify our Father in heaven. If you brought your hands with you, I would definitely encourage you to put them together and glorify God as we sing this song. Give Him praise. Give Him praise. Don't worry about who's on this stage. Don't worry about who's next to you. Don't worry about the empty chair. Don't worry about, you know, whether you're sitting, you're standing, somebody's reading a book, somebody's sending a WhatsApp message. Don't worry about it. You give God the best praise. This is personal this morning. Glory to God.
This is amazing grace. This is amazing. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the gate. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. I sing for all that you've done for me. Let's just meditate on this. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life, yes, Lord, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Amen. This is the reason that we sing, for all that he's done for us, because that is amazing grace. That is unfailing love. This is what grace is all about. This is what grace is, that Christ took your place and he took my place, that we might be able to come here today and worship him and sing glory to him. Let's lift his name up. Let's reverence him. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. with me how great is our God. And all would sing how great is our God. You're the name above all names. You are worthy. Come on, sing with me, how great is our God. And all will sing, how great is our God.
This is your time to worship God and tell Him how great He is. In your own words. Let's not waste this time, but let's just keep telling God how great He is in your life, personally to you, how great God is. God in your life. How great is God in your life this morning? Is He great enough? Is He great enough for you to give Him the first place? Is He great enough for you to prioritize Him? Is He great enough for you to be here when He needs you here? Is He great enough for you to answer that call of duty and say, "Here I am, Lord, send me"? Is He great enough for you to say, "For me to live is Christ and to die is gain"? Is He great enough for you to say, "Lord, all my gifts and all my treasures and all my talents are for you, Lord"? Is He great enough for you to say, "Lord, I surrender my life to you"? Is He great enough? Is He great enough, church?
You're the name above all names. You are worthy.
The name of the Lord. is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are safe. What is your tower? What is your refuge this morning? Sings. Let God manifest Himself in your life. Let His presence be tangible.
Lord, spoken to the Lord, our Lord Jehovah Jireh, our Lord Jehovah Rapha, Adonai, praise God. The Bible says, the one who worships the Lord should worship in the spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. When we worship Him in the spirit and in truth, hallelujah, He manifests Himself. Today, as we are in this physical realm, let us not be detached to the God who is in the spiritual realm. Let us worship and receive what He has kept for us in the spirit. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He is the one who has redeemed us. He has washed us clean. God so loved us that He sent His only begotten Son 2,000 years back, and He came and He died in our place. The one who knew no sin became sin for us, so that in Christ we would all become the righteousness of God. Hallelujah. How many of you have that faith this morning, that in Christ we are hidden and in Christ we are the righteousness of God? Hallelujah. If you have that faith, you can just lift up your hands and acknowledge that as we continue to be in His presence. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank You for this time. As we spend some more moments soaking in Your Spirit, Lord Father, this morning, Father God, we pray that You will fill us with Your Spirit. Let Your Spirit fall on us, Father God. Give us Your revelations, Lord Father. Give us Your understanding, O Lord Father God. Hallelujah. Open our eyes, open the eyes of our heart this morning, Lord. Hallelujah. And as we come closer to You, let Your light shine brightly over us, that whatever is not pleasing to You, Father God, bring those things to the surface so that we will be able to confess and we will be able to, Lord Father, once again renew ourselves in You, Father God. I pray over all Your children who are here in Your presence. Bless each and every one of them. In Jesus' mighty name, we all agree and pray. Amen. Let us all be seated in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. As we come and approach the Lord's table this morning. But before that, I would like all of you to just open your Bibles to a portion, and that is from the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse number 29. Amen. Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse number 29. And this details about how John the Baptist testified about Jesus Christ. And it says in verse number 29, the next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." I want to read that once again. John said, "Look, look, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Amen. This morning, as we read the scripture portion, amen, we have to come to that understanding that we are before that Lamb of God who has already taken away the sin of the world. How many of you have that faith? Hallelujah. If you have that faith, with that faith, we are coming before the Lord's table because it is His sacrament given to the church. Amen. Jesus said we have to do this proclaiming His death, His sacrificial death, until He comes. Praise God. That is our blessed hope. The reason we do it whenever we gather and we do it as often as we can is because our Lord has promised that He is going to come soon. Amen. And when we partake from this table, we once again renew our faith. And we have to understand, when Jesus went on the cross, and as we would commemorate this table, when Bible says, and when John was testifying that He took away the sins of the entire world, we have to understand the significance of it. He was not just saying something for the name's sake. Amen. If you have to understand that significance, we go to the Garden of Eden. In Genesis chapter 3, there is this scene where Adam and Eve fell into sin. They disobeyed God. They fell into sin. And after they fell into sin, they realized that they were naked. Amen. Suddenly they realized that they were naked. Till that point of time, they were naked, but they had no shame. But sin brought shame in their life. And suddenly they realized that they were naked. And they started to look for ways to cover them. Amen. The moment sin enters into our life, there is an instinct that comes in us that we want to cover our sin. We want to hide our sin. You know, that is the importance of we confessing our sins before the Lord, because the human nature is to always hide the sin. You know, we have been designed and wired. The sin factor has brought that thing in our nature that we would want to always cover. But when we look towards the Lamb of God, we have to understand they suddenly realized, Adam and Eve suddenly realized that they were naked, and they started to do everything to cover themselves. They found some fig leaves. You know, if you read Genesis chapter 3, they found some fig leaves and they became the first tailor. And they stitched for themselves dress made out of fig leaves. And when we further see that chapter moving, God did not like that covering. God knew that this covering was not something that would help them to come out of the sin. Amen. What God did was, God had to kill an animal and take the skin of the animal and make a new garment for them. God took out that garment made out of fig leaves. God killed an animal right there in the Garden of Eden. And out of the skin of the animal, God made another dress for them. And God hid their shame. Amen. And that is a wonderful shadow. When we look into the cross of Calvary, throughout the Old Testament, when you read all the Old Testament books, animal sacrifices were needed every year. Every time people would sin, they would have to sacrifice. They would have to shed blood of the animal, and they have to do. But God sent His only begotten Son. Once and for all, He died. He died. His skin took all the beating. His blood was shed. And through the blood of Jesus, we have been all redeemed. Amen. That is our faith. Amen. And as we come before the table, we all have to remember what God accomplished through the sacrifice of Jesus. The entire wrath of God was poured out on Jesus. It was not like the nature of God changed suddenly, that He became very gracious. He poured out all His wrath, that was the punishment of our sin, on one man, that was Jesus. It was His Son who took the form of man. Hallelujah. This morning, as we come before the table, hallelujah, how many of us would come with that heart of remembrance once again and thank God, thank Jesus for His sacrifice. Remember what He accomplished for us on the cross. And also not just celebrate His death and resurrection, but also put our hope in the promise of Jesus when He said that He is going to come soon. That is our hope. When we commemorate from this table, that hope should be renewed. That hope should be renewed. Amen. We should have this hope that my Jesus is going to come soon. My pain, my suffering is going to end. Amen. And that is the reason we come before the table as we are. And as we come before the table, I would encourage all of you, you know, to just once again take this moment of renewal very seriously. Visualize that scene in the Garden of Eden where God had to kill an animal and stitch a new dress out of that animal's skin. God became a tailor for them. But 2,000 years back, God became an eternal tailor for us, where through the sacrifice of His Son, Jesus Christ, He clothed each one of us with Jesus. Bible says, when we are in Christ Jesus, we are a new creation. The old has gone and the new is here. We have been clothed with Jesus. Our tailor, the eternal God, hallelujah, has made way for us that through Jesus, whosoever believes in Jesus will be saved. Whosoever confesses the sin and believes that Jesus is the Son of God and Jesus died for the punishment of the sins, hallelujah, will receive that eternal salvation. And as we come before the table, we all are blessed with that salvation. Amen. But we also have this hope that Jesus is going to come soon. The trumpet is going to sound sooner. Are we ready to hear that sound? Or somewhere we have become deaf, we have ignored the ways of the Lord. If that is the case, this is the time to renew that faith once again. This is the time to confess. This is the time to again come before the Lord and say, Lord, thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for shedding your blood for the forgiveness of my sin. Thank you for becoming a living bread for us. And today we have partaken from that living bread, and today we are alive in Christ Jesus. I welcome all of you to come in prayer. Hallelujah. With a heart of surrender. Father God, we thank you for this time. As we approach the table, we realize that, Lord, we need you every moment of our lives. We are nothing without you. This morning, as we commemorate the table in your remembrance, in the remembrance of your death, sacrificial death, resurrection, and also believing that you are going to come soon, and one day we will be having this bread and the cup together with you when you establish your kingdom here in this earth, Lord. I pray, Father God, for all your children who are preparing themselves, Lord. Let your grace, your compassion be poured out on them, Lord Jesus. Let this be a time of renewal. Let this be a time of restoration. Let this be a time of new decisions. Let this be a time of returning to your purpose, O Lord. Let this be a time of healing, because there is power in the blood. There is power in the blood of the Lamb, and that Lamb was you, Jesus. Commit the rest of the time in your hands. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let us prepare ourselves as we will sing this couple of verses of this hymn. Let us come with a heart of surrender, preparing ourselves in a worthy manner to partake from the table.
Stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and I wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. And my soul shall ever be, oh how marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
I would like to read the scripture portion once again, 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 23 onwards. Apostle Paul writing to the church in Corinth, and today to all of us. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." On the night when Jesus was betrayed, he was with his disciples. He took the bread in his hand and he gave thanks and he broke it, saying, "This is my body that is for you. Whenever you eat of this bread, do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." After that, he took the cup in his hand and said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Today we are under the new covenant of the blood of Jesus. The old has passed away. Old covenant did not have power to save us from our sins. Jesus, the blood of Jesus is the new covenant. Praise God. And today we are under his new covenant. And he said, whenever you drink of this, do this in remembrance of Jesus. The blood of Jesus was shed for us on the cross. His blood washed away all our sin. And that is what we remember. Whenever we partake from the cup and the bread, we are proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. That is our blessed hope. This is not a time to just remember his death and sacrifice in sorrow, but with blessed hope that Jesus finished and accomplished the work on the cross and he washed away all our sins. Praise God. Hallelujah. And he's going to come soon. And we have to be ready. Amen. We have to be ready. Praise God. And the Bible says, so then whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. That is why many among you are weak and ill, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we were more discerning with regard to ourselves, we would not come under such judgment. Nevertheless, when we are judged in this way by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be finally condemned with the world. Couple of things. We have to come before the Lord's table in a worthy manner. Amen. Have a discerning. When we partake from this bread, which is the body of Jesus, praise God, we have to remember his death. We have to discern the body of Christ. We have to discern the blood, because we are partaking and having a communion with his body and with his blood. Amen. Praise God. So if there is anything unworthy, this is the time to just lay it down and say, Lord, I come to you. Wash me clean. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, Jesus gave a couple of sacraments to the church. The first was water baptism. Anyone who is in Christ Jesus is a new creation. So if you are someone who has received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and you are living a life under his Lordship and have received the water baptism, the immersion baptism in the name of Father, Son and the Holy Spirit, this Lord's table invites you. Amen. As you expressed your faith in water baptism, as you would come before the table, this is another expression of your faith, the blessed hope. And also, this is a table of obedience, because we are obeying Lord as we partake from this table. Praise God. So come in obedience, come in surrender, come in a worthy manner. If you are someone who has received Jesus as your Lord and Savior and has received water baptism in the name of Father, Son and the Holy Spirit, you can stand in your place right now. And if you don't understand what I'm talking about, you can come and have a conversation with us later, with the pastors and the leaders, and we would help you to understand. Praise God. What the word tells us, because this bread signifies the body of Jesus Christ that was broken for us. Praise God. You know, the bread and the cup will come to you. You can take it in your hand, both the bread and the cup, and wait for all the others to also have it. And at the end, with a word of prayer, we will have it together, proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. Praise God. Let this be a time of restoration. Let this be a time of renewal. Let this be a time of healing. Let this be a time of God's power being manifested in our physical bodies. Praise God. I will request Sister Prabha to please come forward. And also Sister CG, if you can come forward from the sister's side. Sister Prabha and Sister CG. And from brother's side, I'll request Pastor Benson and Brother Chandra to please come forward and help in the giving of the cup and the bread. Praise God.
He took my sins and my sorrows. He made them his very own. He bore the burden. suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Jesus. When with the ransomed in glory His face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of His love for me. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my soul shall marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
The cup is in our hands, the bread is in our hands. Praise God, let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your sacrifice as we remember your sacrificial death and we celebrate your resurrection power. And we also, Father God, come in that blessed hope that you're going to come soon, Father God. As we partake from these elements, Lord Father, let this be a time of restoration and a healing and a manifestation of your power in our bodies, in our spirits, in our soul as well, Lord Father. I bless this in the name of Jesus. Let your name be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us have from it. Amen. We can all, after having the elements, be seated in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. There are still bread and wine that is left in the table. That signifies that there are many out there who have not yet received Jesus. So this is a time to also commit into the Great Commission, saying, Lord, yes, I will be the witness for you in this world, and I will share you with many others who have not yet received your salvation, Lord. So I will request Brother Mohandas to please come forward and lead us in the next part of the service.
Praise the Lord. As we are entering into the next phase of the service, we would like to welcome newcomers who have come for the first time to the DC Family Church. Anyone who has come for the first time, please, brother, introduce yourself.
My name is Joshua, and I've come from Pimpri.
You're from?
Pimpri.
Pimpri.
Yeah.
Brother, okay. Brother Joshua, we'll welcome you. He's from Pimpri. Our brother Matthew's son. We welcome you. So the next thing is that we have a birthday celebration from 1st April to 7th of April this week. And we have very talented children who are born in this week. We have Sharon Pramod Raut and Sharon Pramod Raut. They are the twin brothers and sisters of Brother Pramod and Sister Barkha. If they are there, I request them. Okay. We have Brother Pramod. God has blessed them with wonderful children. we have then Felix. He is born on April 3rd. Then Mahima and Rikil Joseph. They are all and Sanjay Kudde. They all are born on April 3rd. And we give all glory, honor, and praise to God for their life. And Felix is the younger son of Brother Wilson, and he turned 1 year old on 3rd of April. So we thank God for that also. We request them or even next service. The Maima is there. Come forward, Maima. Then we have Sean Peter and Alicia Peter. They have celebrated their birthday on April 5th. So they are talented children of God. I think they have gone for the Sunday school. And we thank God for their life also. Now we'll get into the intercessory prayer. Even though we have empty chairs, I think we should be keep praying for these empty chairs, and God definitely is going to fill those chairs. It is our responsibility in the kingdom of God. And definitely I would like to add here that, as Brother Richard said, that we need fuel every now and then for our vehicles. The same way in our spiritual life, we need that fueling of our spirit, so that our spiritual life will always be filled with power and grace of God. And that's the reason, I think, if we see the schedule of our church services, Saturday, Sunday, then we have on Wednesday evening Bible study, then Friday we have an intercessory prayer. I think every alternate day we have some activities, and definitely that is helping us to be always on that path of righteousness, always in the presence of God, especially the Wednesday Bible study. Pastor Benson really takes us through the Word of God. He elaborates on in a such a way that even the small children will understand that, and they will also be encouraged. So I encourage all of you that take out some time and join for these meetings. Definitely that will elevate us in our spiritual life. So I encourage all of you to join. Even the Friday intercessory prayer, even on the first Friday, the afternoon intercessory prayer, even though some of us are not able to join, but whoever is joining, I have actually understood from them that God is answering all our prayers, and it is helping the ministry and the church to grow in the kingdom of God. So please remember all these things in your prayers also. Set apart, I think I like that word for the youth which church has kept, that set apart. We have to set apart our time, our commitments for the kingdom of God. Now we'll pray for the further request, like Sister Ria's mother. We know that God has healed her, and we believe that our prayers are answered. They are serving the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So God definitely is taking care of them, and we believe, and definitely we'll hear the testimony maybe in coming weeks when they will go for the checkup, that God definitely has healed their bones, and without operation at this age also God has healed them. That is the encouragement definitely we all of us will get. We have elderly parents in midst of us. We need to uphold them into the God's hand. And similarly, we have to pray for that some of the church members who are going through the illness. So Sister Nalini, she is suffering from the stomach infection from last 1 week, and we need to pray for all of them. Any other prayer requests, if we have, we will definitely pray. You can tell us. We'll pray for the children's exam and as well as the result. Exams have happened, and definitely God is going to give them the wonderful victory in their exams. We have to pray for the Lok Sabha elections. This is most important elections of this country, our country, and definitely God will answer our prayer if we are faithful in our prayers. And we will keep praying for that. We have to pray for all the pastors and churches who are going through all the persecutions and false accusations. And definitely God will answer us. We are living in definitely a comfortable environment over here in Pune. But there are areas where, especially in Northeast and some part of the Maharashtra, that definitely the persecution is taking place. So we will pray for that, and we will uphold every prayer request. So let's bow down our heads and let's pray. Lord, once again we come to your feet, O Father. We know that you are over here, O Father. Your presence is here, O Father. And Lord, we are thankful to you for such a wonderful time you have given to us, O Father. Lord, as we are interceding, O Father, this is the most important thing. We can do it for you and your people, O Father. We can pray hours and hours for ourselves, O Father, but interceding for our brothers and sisters and the needy, O Lord God, that is the greatest thing, O Father. Help us that we should be always interceding, for so many prayer requests are there, O Father. Endless prayer requests are there, O Father. We believe that if we kneel down, if we uphold our hands towards you, your grace, the throne of grace, O Father, definitely every prayer will be answered, O Father. Right now we commit us, Sister Ria's mother, into your hand. We believe, O Father, that you have healed her, O Father. You have protected her, Father, O Lord God. You have shown your great mercy upon her, Father, O Lord God. And we believe that in coming weeks, O Father, we will hear that testimony. Without any operations, O Lord God, you have healed her, O Lord God. She will come on her own legs, O Lord God, and she will testify in this place, O Lord God, to glorify your name, O Father, because you are a faithful prayer answering God. You are our Jehovah Rapha, our healer, O Lord God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we pray for all our elderly parents, O Lord God, who are going through this age, O Lord God, this phase of their life, O Father. But we pray your grace is more than sufficient for your children, O Lord God. Lord, we pray, O Father, you hold them into your hand, O Father. Keep them away from every sickness, every disease, every accident, O Lord God. And we believe that you are taking care of them, O Father. Give them the grace, O Father. And we believe, O Father, that you are with them, O Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Once again, we commit everything into your hand. We especially pray for all the children, O Lord God, who are celebrating their birthdays in this week, O Father. We uplift them into your hand. Especially, O Lord God, we are happy that all our children are in the presence of God, in the house of God, O Father. That is the safest place, O Lord God, in this world, O Father. And we are thankful to you that they are in this place, O Father. We, Lord, we commit their entire future into your hand, O Father. Lord, you fill them with your divine wisdom, knowledge, understanding, of Father. Let the fear of God always be there in front of them, O Father, so that their life will be a blessed one, protected one, and they will become a great vessels in the kingdom of God in coming days, O Father. Lord, they will not go away from the word of God and the path of righteousness, O Father. And Lord, we believe that one day they will be proclaiming the word of God, the salvation, the sacrifice of Jesus, O Lord God, so that they will also become a soul winner in coming days, O Father. Lord, we especially pray for the upcoming elections, O Lord God, of our country, O Father. Lord, this is the most important election of this country, O Lord God. We pray, O Father, that let the right candidate, O Lord God, should win, O Father. Lord, not only that, O Father, but we pray for all the voters, O Lord God, who should vote faithfully and truthfully, O Father. And Lord, we believe, O Father, that you will answer our prayer, O Father. The right government will come, O Father, where there should not be any constitutional change should take place, O Father, but we will have our right to worship you, O Father, and Lord, according to the constitution, O Father. Lord, we pray, O Father, that the right party should come in the government, O Father, and we believe that all our prayers will be answered, O Father. This is the important important thing, O Father, that we should be praying, O Father, from next week onwards, O Lord God, the voting is taking place, O Father. Let the people should choose the right candidate to serve them, O Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Lord, we pray for all the ministries, all your servant of God, O Father, who are serving you faithfully, truthfully, and sacrificially, O Father. Lord, we especially pray for the North India, O Father, and some part of Maharashtra also, where we have seen and heard, O Father, and read that there are persecutions are taking place, O Father, false accusations are taking place. But we pray, O Father, we have heard the testimonies, O Father, the pastors who were in the jail, they have come out, O Father. We pray, O Father, that praying from this place, O Lord God, definitely are getting answered, O Father. We need to be faithful, at least in praying and interceding for such a issues, O Lord God. And we know that definitely the victory belongs to your people, O Father. Even though we are going through the persecution and hard times, O Lord God, we believe that your servant will go forward, O Father, taking the salvation of God into the people's life, O Lord God. O Lord, we especially pray for their families, O Lord God. Protect them, O Father, and provide every need of their life, O Lord God. Thank you, Father. Lord, we pray that let them get the proper lawyers and advocates who will fight the case for them truthfully, O Father. We know that you are a God of all wisdom and knowledge, and we know that you will provide them the wisdom and knowledge to fight the case, and they will come out, because ultimately the truth is going to win, because you are a true God and faithful and prayer answering God, O Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Once again, we commit everything into your hand. We pray for all the empty chairs, O Lord God. We pray and we intercede, O Father. Let the many people, many souls come in this place to be blessed, to be protected, and to become the part of the eternal life in coming days. Once again, we commit entire time into your hand. The word of God, which is going to come through you, O Father, we believe that will definitely encourage us, O Lord God, and definitely it will enhance our spiritual level, O Lord God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now let's welcome Pastor Jason. Let's clap.
Thank you, brother. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Can we just lift up our hands and shout a big hallelujah? Praise God. I know we all are tired because of the summer heat, but you know, seasons are orchestrated by God. Amen. How many of you believe that summer was created by God? Yes. So if God created something, he did not create it to harm us, but you know, when we go through different seasons, that gives us a profound learning about life as well, because life has different seasons, but in every season God is the one who rules our heart. Praise God. How many of you can say that with a heart of faith? Yes, God is my king. Amen. God is my king. Yes, Jesus is my king. Praise God. Hallelujah. So we have entered into the fourth month of this year, and you know, April, you know, I still have fond memories of April, because growing up as a kid, it was very, very you know, exciting month in terms of having Pastor Benson as a kid, who was a very mischievous child. So April 1, when I would sleep on a March 31st, I would always remind myself the next day is April 1. Because anytime, you know, with having Pastor Benson in the house, you can expect anything. Yeah. So April Fool's Day is something that we all remember. Yes. But you know, when we read Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 10, Apostle Paul writes to the church in Corinth, we are fools for Christ's sake. Yeah, we are fools for Christ. Amen. Because the message of the cross is like foolishness for the world. When we stand for the cross, the world will call us fools. But how many would take it as something like a badge and you can say, yes, I'm a fool for Christ. How many can say that? I'm a fool for Christ. Yes. You know, unless you become foolish for Christ, you cannot represent the message of the cross. That is a clear message. Unless you're ready to be fools for Christ, whatever be your designation, yeah, you may be a senior vice president, you may be an executive vice president, you may become a CEO, Praise God, but you should carry that badge. Yes, I am a fool for Christ, because wherever I go, I cannot stop myself but proclaim what Jesus did for me. Amen. That is our faith. Amen. And that faith always, would be challenging. So April Fools, fond memories of April Fools. But, you know, when we come to this particular month, it is like a second quarter of this year. You know, how many of you still remember some of the resolutions that you took on January 1st? You still remember? Yeah? Because this is a time when we suddenly start to forget everything, yeah? What we decided, and even we sometimes forget, you know, when we entered as a church, it is a year of divine preparation. We have to keep on reminding, yes, that Jesus is going to come soon. Amen? So this month is not just another month, but this month is another month for me to get renewed. This month is another month for me to get aligned with God, because that is what I hear very clearly, because there is a need for certain alignment. Yeah? Align, then pray, and then receive. Align, then pray, and then receive in the Lord. Because unless there is an alignment, you know, the prayer is falling somewhere else. Praise God. God wants us to align our lives according to His word. Amen. Because as, someone who is a passionate for graphic designs as well, you know, there is one thing that is very, very, you know, important when you create any designs is alignment. You cannot have different objects in a design completely in a non-aligned way. Everything has to be aligned properly. Praise God. Then only the real message comes out. Praise God. Sometimes in our life, we may think that everything is fine. Yeah, we live in a country where chalta hai attitude is very popular. Chalta hai. You know, we see something happening wrong, chalta hai. But if there is something that Lord brings out in your own life, don't ever say chalta hai. Right? Stop there and say, Lord, I don't want to go in a non-aligned way. Amen. How many of you remember that for our freedom, there was a non-aligned movement? Yeah. That was done by freedom fighters. They were ready. They say, we are not going to align with the British rule. We are going to do everything to get our freedom. But let me tell you, Jesus Christ left the glory of heaven. He died for us on the cross. Amen. It was very easy for him to be aligned with Father God in heaven. But he became non-aligned with Father God. He reached to a place where Father God forsake him. And then Jesus had to cry out, Father, why have you forsaken me? And the reason for that non-aligned thing that happened that point of history was so that we all can be aligned back to God. How many of you believe that? That is the story of the gospel. You know, and the story of the gospel should not take us to a complacent place. You know, we have to rejoice in the gospel. We have to proclaim the gospel. We have to live out the gospel. Nothing but the gospel of Jesus has power. Praise God. Because it is the gospel that has the power of God that leads anyone to salvation. And today, that gospel has brought us to salvation. Praise God. So this morning, as we enter into this month, you know, we will spend some time to learn about that divine alignment. Because there is a popular term in the corporate, which we normally use in the corporate, is in sync. Are you in sync with me? Yeah, because sometimes where there is a project discussion, that is a very important question that after all the discussion, people would ask, are we all in sync with each other? Are we all on the same page? Because if we are not in sync with each other, how much ever you try to execute on the project will be a failure, right? So how many of you believe that your life is a big project that is managed by God? Amen. And He wants us to be aligned with Him. He does not want us to be out of sync. Amen. And that is the Holy Spirit that is given to us, which always would remind us, which always would encourage us, come back to God. Turn to God. Be in sync with God. Don't go out of sync. You have been out of sync last week. This is the time you have to come back. Praise God. Many of the chairs are empty here, but I am glad that some of them have joined through Zoom. They took time to connect online as well so that they want to be in sync with the work of the Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. Some of them are watching from Zoom. Some of them are watching from YouTube. We have to realize that we are living in a world where we need to be in sync with God. We have to be divinely aligned with God. Because let me give you three words. You know, alignment will bring authority. Praise God. And that authority comes through anointing. Right? Alignment, anointing, authority.
Unless you're aligned, you know, that anointing won't work in your life. Anointing won't be received by you. Praise God. And it is that anointing that leads you to the place of authority. Amen. Today we have been given the name of Jesus. That is our authority. Praise God. But before we call out the name of Jesus, amen, we have to be aligned with him, because that is the danger. You know, we may call him Lord, Lord, but on that day, if we hear back from him, I don't know you. That is a very terrific situation. How many of you want to be in that situation? No. You know, it's like just taking your badge that you have, your ID card, and suddenly swiping it and figuring out that the door is not opening. What is the next thought that, oh, am I being investigated from my job? Right? That day, if we are not ready, if we are not prepared ourselves, it can happen. So that is the reason alignment is very much needed. But today, when we are thinking about being in sync, and this is a very practical thing, because, you know, when it comes to Bible, Bible is not theoretical, it is practical. Bible is basic instructions before leaving earth. Amen. And that is the reason we need to get Bible into our hearts. Praise God. So when we read Bible, we have to understand, how does this in sync, or how does this divine alignment come? Praise God. There is one thing that is in us, and many places in the Bible, we see that term repeated, is our heart. Everyone say heart. Yeah, H-E-A-R-T, heart. Praise God. Many places in the Bible, we see the term used, heart. And we all love to use it in the world as well, because, you know, entire film industry is based on that little thing that beats inside our heart. Yeah, beats inside our chest cavity, isn't it? Heart. But we have to understand, what is this heart? You know, first thing that I would like to present is a man who was called a man after God's own heart. Who was that? David. Amen. David was a shepherd boy. Amen. David was introduced as someone who was a man after God's own heart. Amen. He had a heart that was after God's own heart. And that is what we read. Can we turn our Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 13, verses 13 and 14. 1 Samuel chapter 13, verse 13 and 14. Here we see Samuel talking to Saul. He is the king. Amen. Saul is the king, and he has ruled over Israel for 42 years. And there comes a place in his ruling that God has rejected Saul. Amen. Because he disobeyed. And Samuel is clearly pronouncing it to Saul, and he's saying, "You have done a foolish thing," Samuel said. "You have not kept the command the Lord your God gave you. If you had, he would have established your kingdom over Israel for all the time." Praise God. So what is happening here? We are seeing a person whose name is Saul. He is not a person, he's a king. Amen. He is a king, Saul, who was selected by God, who ruled over Israel for 42 years. And here we see that because he did not keep the command of the Lord, he is being rejected by God. Amen. When you don't keep the command of the Lord, what is happening? You are going in a non-aligned state. Amen. How do I come in sync with God? How do I align myself with God's will? By obeying his command. And here we see a pathetic king. Amen. Who was someone who was selected and appointed by God himself, now disobeying God's command and finding more worth in his self. Amen. And God rejected him. Amen. That is a very dangerous place. God rejected Saul, and Samuel says in verse number 14 of 1 Samuel 13, he says, "But now your kingdom will not endure." And then he says, "The Lord has sought out a man after his own heart and appointed him ruler of his people, because you have not kept the Lord's command." So what do we read here? Because Saul disobeyed, God was not taken by surprise. Amen. Suddenly, you know, as a manager in working in a cooperative, you suddenly get a resignation letter, you are worried because now you have to find a replacement. God was not worried when Saul disobeyed God, because God already had sought someone who was a man after God's own heart, and that was David. Amen. The moment Saul was going into disobedience, God rejected Saul and said, "No, your kingdom is not going to endure." You know, some of our life should be seen from the lens of this scripture. Amen. How important it is for us to walk in the ways of the Lord, because we can easily fall in the place of Saul, We can lose our authority. We can lose our anointing if we don't obey the Lord. Amen. Here, God is telling, Samuel is telling, God has already sought out. You know, what do you mean by the word sought out? God searched for a man after God's own heart. You know, how many of you believe that today, God has a search engine running from heaven? Amen. And that search engine is eternal. More powerful than Google or any other search engines. God's eye is searching the hearts of the people who are residing in this earth. You know, from west to east, from north to south, he's running through this world and seeing who is an individual after my own heart. Praise God. And God had already sought out and found a man after his own heart, and that was David. And Samuel pronouncing that, you know, your kingdom is gone. God has already found a man after God's own heart. Now let us understand this. You know, when David was a man after God's own heart, and when we hear the term heart, because of all these things and the patterns of the world, we have actually missed the meaning of the word called heart. We have to come back to what the Bible says about heart. We have to know, what is this heart? You know, the moment we say heart, we think it is all about emotions. It is all about love. It is all about feelings. We try to box our heart into these small, trivial things. But let me tell you, when you weigh heart in biblical terms, we can find more depth, and we have to understand that is what, when God said that I sought out for someone and I found a man after God's own heart. Right? The first thing, you know, we have to understand that heart can be divided into three parts. And the first part is called the mind. You know, sometimes we think that mind is not part of the heart. But there is a mind that is a very significant part of the heart. Second is emotions, which we all know. Love, feelings, you know, desires, imaginations, emotions. Everything is in that heart. It bursts from heart. And that is the second part, that is called affection or even emotions. The third part of the heart is called the will. Everyone say will. Yeah? We have our own human will. Praise God. We choose and we determine our next action step. Isn't it? That also births from our heart. Now let's try to understand, because when I'm saying that mind is part of the heart, I'm not saying based on my own thoughts or own way of thinking. I am saying is based on the scripture. Let us turn our Bibles to Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13, verse number 15. Praise God. Here, you know, Jesus is talking to his disciples, and disciples have asked a question, why do you always teach in parables? Right? Parable is earthly story with heavenly meaning. And these parables were sometimes very complex, because sometimes the disciples had to come and ask the meaning of the parable. And here, disciples ask the question, Jesus, why do you always teach in parables? And on answering that question, Jesus mentions this thing in verse number 15 on Matthew chapter 13. He says, for this people's heart has been calloused. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn. What is mentioned here? They would understand with their hearts. Did the Bible or did Jesus say that they will understand with their brains? What did Jesus say? Understand with their hearts. So what does that mean? There is a mind aspect in our heart as well. Praise God. So when we are talking about renewal of mind, do not detach mind outside of your heart. Praise God. If the Lord is not the ruler of your heart, don't ever think that your mind will be renewed. How many of you are getting it? Praise God. If you have to step into that renewal process, Lord has to rule over your hearts. You have to give the first priority to God in your hearts. Unless that happens, there is not going to be any renewal. Praise God. So when it comes to coming in sync with God, yeah, I have to come in sync. I have to align with God. We have to understand that there is this mind aspect in God, in the heart. Amen. We have to understand with our heart the words of the Lord. So when we come before the word, it is not just using our brain, but also pouring out our hearts before the word of the Lord and say, Lord, heal my heart. That is the reason we sing the song. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Praise God. What does that mean? If your eyes of the heart are closed, that means there is this mind aspect that has been veiled. Amen. And you're not going to receive the life-giving word. How many will say an amen? Praise God. That is one thing that we have to understand, that mind is a part of heart as well. And the second thing is affection and emotions. When I say that affection and emotions are part of the heart, we all know that. You know, Psalm number 20, verse number 4, and this is a favorite verse for us. You know, Psalm 20, verse number 4, it says, may he give you the desire of your heart and make all your plans succeed. This is a Psalm of David. And we would like to paste this scripture everywhere. Amen. We have so many desires. How many of you desires to purchase a Lamborghini? Yeah, many of us have so many worldly desires, isn't it? I want that, I want this, I want that, I want the best job, I want to have the best, you know, some of the unmarried people, best wife, best husband, yeah? These are the desires of your heart. And when we come to Psalm number 20, verse 4, it says, may he give you the desire of your heart. So earlier we understood that we use heart to understand. Now we see the word of God is telling that desires are in the heart. Praise God. So there is this desires, emotions, longings that are part of this heart. And as a human being, we should acknowledge it. Praise God. But when it comes to coming in sync with God, we have to ask God, Lord, I don't want to have any desire which is not your desire for me. How many of you are getting it? You know, sometimes we desire outside God. We desire for something which is completely outside the will of God. So there is an important thing that should happen is alignment of our desire with the desire of God. And how do I know the desire of God? If I have to know the desire of God, I have to come before the word and I have to pour out my heart. Praise God. I have to say, Lord, you know, clean my heart, right? Clean those desires which are not your desires. Give me those desires that are the heavenly desires so that I will be able to live according to your will and I will align myself to your purpose. How many will say an amen? Praise God. This is something that we should understand. There is affection which is a critical part of the heart. The third thing which I said was will. Everyone say will. Amen. Right? So we all know about will, right? Human will. Right? Sometimes we say, you know, I will and I will do it. Yeah, it is my will and I will do it, right? So let's turn our Bibles to Proverbs chapter 3, verse number 5. Proverbs chapter 3, verse number 5. And this is also another favorite verse for many of us, right? This is not a new verse. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. So what does the word say here? Trust in the Lord with what? With all your heart. What do you mean by trust? Can you trust someone outside your will? Can you trust someone outside your human will? No. If you have to trust someone, you have to align your will to that thing that is called trust. Because unless there is a will that is birthing inside of you, you cannot trust someone. But what does the Bible say in Proverbs 3:5? How do we need to trust the Lord? Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Now, today the word may throw some light and make some of us uncomfortable. You know, sometimes our trust is with 40% of our heart. Let me tell you. Now, we don't trust God wholeheartedly. We may say, oh Lord, I trust you. But then our trust is in so many other things. Right? We all know about the Bible verse, it is better to trust in the Lord than to put your trust in the princes of the world, in the chariot, in the horses. We know that it is better to trust in the Lord, but when it comes in the critical juncture of our life, our trust is placed on everything else but God. And the Bible says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Praise God. So what is that? There is this will aspect. Unless there is a will in your heart, you cannot trust. So there are three things which we understand. Mind, emotions or affections, and third is will. Praise God. And this understanding of your heart should help you to come in sync with God. The reason I opened up the scriptures to make you understand is, unless you understand what is this biblical heart, you will not be able to come in sync with God. So next time when you come to God and you say, and you find a word in the scripture where it is written with all your heart, you have to understand that it is not only talking about your emotions or feelings. It is talking about your mind. It is talking about your emotions. It is talking about your will as well, which is not detached from your heart. How many will say an amen? Praise God. This is something that we have to learn from the scriptures, right? And the second thing that I want to, say is, we all, when we talk about coming in sync with God, we have to understand that we need to set the right target for us when we are living as a child of God in this earth. Because we all want to have some targets, but we have to define the right target. Because some of us, what we do, we set target, but that is a wrong target. Even if we reach that target, we will still be unsuccessful. Praise God. How many of us has experienced that, sometimes you achieve something, but that does not give you that joy. You would be striving and doing hard work so many years. I want that. And suddenly you have it. You don't have that joy. Because that is not the target what was defined by God. Because if there is a target which is defined by God, the moment you reach it, amen, you may be like a wounded soldier, but inside you will be full of joy which cannot be diminished by any powers of the world. Amen. That is the reason we need to be in sync with the Lord. And that is the important aspect that I want to bring. In Matthew chapter 16 verse 26, and this is the words of Jesus, Matthew 16, 26. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? Amen. This is a very critical question that we need to ask ourselves every day. What good can I, put yourself in that place, what good can I gain? Right? What good will happen to me if I gain the entire world but I lose my soul? Amen. We are in a rat race today that we want to have everything in this world, but in that rat race, sometimes we lose our soul. And Jesus is asking a very critical question. What good will happen for you if you gain the entire world, but you lose your soul because you are non-aligned with God? Amen. And that is to have the right target. And I want to tell you a story so that it will stick with you. It's a true story. Praise God. There is this, shooter whose name is Matt Emmons. Yeah, Matt Emmons. He is a shooter, rifle shooter. He's an Olympian. Right? He is from United States. He participated in 4 Olympics. 2004, Athens Olympics, 2008, Beijing Olympics, 2012, London, and even 2016, he participated representing his country in the shooting championship. In 2004 Athens Olympics, he was participating in this 50-meter rifle shooting. And he reached the final round. And he was the most privileged. He was considered to be the one who would win the gold medal because he was that good. Right? In the final round, we all know how do they take the stance for shooting, isn't it? They take the rifle, they look into the target, and it is a 50-meter shooting, isn't it? He took the rifle in his hand. It is a final round, right? And because it was a final round, there was this board that was in front of him where he had to shoot, right? Anywhere in the board, if that bullet goes and imprints or stuck, he will win the gold. That was the thing that was left for him. The final round of shooting. He was very confident. He took the rifle and he shot. And the bullet went and it struck the bullseye. But the unfortunate thing was, it struck the bullseye of another competitor's board. Praise God. Everyone was astonished. He was standing in lane number 2. But when he took the shot, it went and hit the bullseye of lane number 3. What happened? His score was still 0. He was supposed to win the gold medal if he would have just hit his board anywhere. No bullseye needed. But because he missed the entire target, what happened? He dropped to 8th position. Praise God. Some of us are taking our target and we are thinking that we are winning the race. Oh, we are hitting bullseye every day. We are hitting bullseye. I'm getting promotions. I'm getting success. I'm getting money. My relationships are thriving. But let me tell you, is that target the right target? What will you gain in goodness if you gain the entire world but lose your soul? Praise God. So coming in sync with God means is to define the right target. And when you have to define the right target, you have to also take some decisions for tomorrow. Praise God. You know, sometimes we come to the Lord and we don't think about our tomorrow. Right? The decisions that you are taking, the when you commit your life in your youth, what decision you are taking, you're taking a decision for your entire lifetime. Praise God. Remember your Lord in the days of your youth. There is a meaning for that verse. Amen. We have to come in sync with God in our youth. Praise God. It is not that when I'm in my deathbed that I will ask forgiveness for my sins. Yes, Jesus will still forgive you. But what was the word? Remember your Creator in the days of your youth, because the decisions that you take today, the target that you are setting for your life today, is determining your tomorrow. Praise God. As I end, praise God, I want to tell this another illustration to make you understand. There was this big aeroplane, a Boeing aeroplane that was landing in an airport. And the pilot was all set to land that big plane in the airport, in the airfield. And as he was bringing that airplane down and down and down, and when it reached the final landing, there was sudden crosswinds. Lot of wind, lot of turbulence started to come against the plane. And it came to a point where pilot was losing control to land the plane. Praise God. And as soon as he was trying to land the plane, the wheels were shaking and the plane was shaking. And it came to a point that if he would touch base, the plane would crash. In a split of a second, that pilot took a decision. The pilot, you know, hit the throttle and he pulled the trigger and he once again took the plane back to the air. He aborted the landing. And because he took that decision in a split second, the lives of the entire, you know, passenger fleet was saved because of his quick decision. And after that, when he took into the air, he circled around the airport two or three times, and when weather became okay, then he landed the plane safely. After the plane landed safely, all the passengers were terrified. You know, they came out and they thanked the pilot. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. And one of the passengers asked a question. You know, when did you decide? On what point did you decide that the plane should not land and it should again go back to the air? The pilot gave a very astounding answer. He said, I decided 15 years back when I was being trained as a pilot. Because I went through so many simulations while I was being trained. I was trained that if such situations will come in my life, if there would be a crisis in the flight, I have to take this step. And I was ready 15 years back. And the decision that I took 15 years to attend my training faithfully bear fruit at this point. Let me tell you. Amen. How many of you can stand in the shoe of that pilot and consider that your life is also an airplane? There will be so many turbulence that you may face in the future. Do not come running before God to say, Lord, help me when you face another crisis. But the Lord is asking you, align your life according to the will of God. When you are, you know, being trained under the Holy Spirit, this is the time to take the decision that I will follow my God. Do not wait from crisis to crisis and cry and say, Lord, save me. But be trained that when the next crisis comes in your life, you can look to the crisis and say, my God is bigger than you crisis. Hallelujah. I trust in my Lord and I know what I need to do in this crisis. I will look unto the Lord and he will rescue me. How many of you will say an amen? Praise God. Hallelujah. That is what the pilot teaches us. Praise God. Hallelujah. Set the right target at the right time. Amen. You are here for a purpose. Do not consider that you are in Pune by mistake. Hallelujah. You are in Pune because God had a definite purpose, and you will also take flight. You will go to places. There will be challenges that you will face, but be prepared, be equipped, and say, Lord, I come and I align my life according to thy will. Let your will be done in my life. Not my will, O Lord. Hallelujah. I lay down my desires. I lay down my affection. I lay down my ambition before you, O Lord. Whatever you will, let it happen in my life. If you are ready to do that, you are taking a crucial decision that will equip you to impact many lives in the future. Hallelujah. You know, there are children whom you will father or mother one day will thank you because you prepared yourself in the Lord. You aligned your life in the right time before the Lord. You took a crucial decision to say, I will follow Jesus. I will leave the world behind. I will place the cross above ahead of me, and I will walk according to what Jesus has said in my life. How many will say an amen? Can we close our eyes? Praise God. Hallelujah. As the time has gone past, praise God. Hallelujah. We'll continue next week as well. Praise God. You know, this is a call. You know, take crucial decisions for tomorrow today. Amen. Do not delay. Do not delay. You know, I know that there are going to be so many delays. You may start to think that I can delay my decision for maybe next year. You know, let me get at least till marriage. Let me live my life according to my will. Let me tell you, that is going to be too late. Hallelujah. When the situation is good, when you can take a decision today. Hallelujah. How many will take a decision today? Can you close your eyes? Hallelujah. You know, as a posture of surrender, you can stand in your place as well. Praise God. As we would, you know, conclude with a word of prayer. Praise God. Hallelujah. You know, God is here, and he says that he will never leave us nor forsake us. Hallelujah. His word is eternal. Hallelujah. He is telling that yes, there is a better future for you, but don't wait for the better future without taking those crucial decisions of aligning yourself to the will of God today. Hallelujah. How is your life today? What good will you receive if you gain the entire world but you lose your soul? Amen. Soul is very important. Hallelujah. Jesus died so that he would purchase your soul, so that your soul will not go into destruction. Amen. This is a time to say, Lord, I come back to you. Amen. And if you are surrendering yourself, let me tell you, you know, Jesus is a compassionate, gracious God. Hallelujah. He's not someone who would say that you do something and then you come to me. Jesus is telling, are you ready to take a new decision today? You know a part of your heart that is not committed to God. Maybe that part you only know and God knows. And God is waiting. Are you ready to surrender that part of your heart, that part of your life, to also in the hands of God? Hallelujah. Praise God. Because in the times of crisis, the decision that you take today to align yourself to God will help you to, you know, go ahead without any crashes. Amen. Hallelujah. The enemy will try to say, no, 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 don't take the decision. It is okay. You know, look around you. There are so many friends enjoying every day. If you take this decision, how will you even manage to stand with them? But how many will say, yes, I will leave everything behind. For me, Jesus is all in all. Hallelujah. He is my Lord. He is my Savior. And I want to commit my life once again into the hands of Jesus. If you are someone, hallelujah, let us pray. Hallelujah. Father God, I pray over your children, Lord Father, as they are surrendering. Let this word that has been sown as a seed, Father, bring fruit in their lives, Father God. Let this, Lord, word of God transform them, Lord Father. Let every one of us, Father, come to, Lord, hallelujah, you in alignment, O Lord Father. I come against the spirit of non-alignment that comes from the enemy. Let it be demolished, Lord Father. Every human thought, every human will that is against your will, I take it captive in the name of Jesus, Father God. Lord, heal and free your people, Lord Father. Thank you for listening and answering our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Can we lift up our hands and say, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Shout out, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We will sing this song and we'll rejoice in the Lord. We'll worship him and we'll thank him for his goodness. And we'll also take this time to offer unto the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, as we are worshiping and as singing this song, praise God. You know, don't step out of this place without taking a new decision. Hallelujah. I've already taken a decision. Confirm it. and say, Lord, yes, I don't want to be without you. I will be with you always. Praise God, because you are with me always. Let us rejoice in the Lord. Amen.
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning.
Father, you are more than enough for me. Hallelujah. Our most holy and gracious Abba Father in heaven, we thank you for this time, Lord Father, as we conclude this service. We once again want to surrender ourselves into your mighty hands, Father God. Let your will alone be done in our lives, Father God. Help us to be in sync with your heart, O Lord. Give us a heart that will be after your heart, O Lord Jesus. Lord, our mind, our will, our emotions, our feelings, our desires, everything we lay down before you. Lord, rebuild everything according to thy will. Let that alignment come into pass, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray, Father God. Hallelujah. I pray for all your children, all the families here, Father God. Bless them. Let them have a very fruitful week in you, O Lord, Father. Lord, there are challenges, but the decisions that they have taken, Lord, Father, help them to take flight in the middle of those challenges, Lord Father. I cancel everything that is from the enemy. All the fear, all the lies. Free your people, Lord Father. Free families. Build relationships. Let your will be done. I pray for all the people once again who are sick. Your word says, Lord Father, by your stripes we have been healed. I release that word once again into their lives, Father God. In the name of Jesus, let them be healed. I pray for the offering that has been offered in your presence, O Lord. Lord, we have not given anything outside of what you have already blessed us with, O Lord Jesus. Our life belongs to you. Everything that we have belongs to you, Father God. Lord, bless your people. Bless your children, Father, who have extended their hands unto the offering. Those who could not extend as well, Lord Father, we pray over them as well. Bless them as well, Lord Father. Let your kingdom come. Let this be used for the expansion of your kingdom according to thy will, Lord. Be with us. Let that peace follow us, lead us throughout this week. Thank you for your amazing presence, for your word that gives us life. Help us to live a life of spirit, Lord Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we all agree. And the church said, Amen. Amen. Let us all lift up our hands as we receive this benediction in faith. Hallelujah. May the love of God the Father and the grace of His Son Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and the sweet communion and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of us until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. May God bless all of you. We would be transitioning into the Hindi service, but before that, a few announcements. We will be having Wednesday, Friday meetings over Zoom. Wednesday Bible study is there in the evening. Friday intercessory prayer in the evening. Saturday prayer watch in the evening.
But today evening we have a sports fellowship. So outdoor sports fellowship is being arranged for all age groups, right? So we have a turf booked Reboot Arena. You are invited. If you are available 7 p.m. till 9 p.m. we'll be having a sports fellowship where we will be coming together in the fellowship of the Lord and spending some time together. Praise God. May God. We also have sisters fellowship this coming Saturday. If you are wondering where all these things are happening, if you are not part of any group, just raise your hand, say I want to be part of that WhatsApp group where all these things are being decided. So we will be happy to add you also in your group. Okay, so greet each other. Have a blessed week. May the Lord Jesus continue to rule your life, your families. May you be blessed. Amen. All who have joined over Zoom, God bless you as well. We have few sweets here. Birthday boys and girls are here. So let us all take time to pray over them as well. And I would also hand their gifts. I will request if Sean is available. Sean, Peter can come forward. Sean, Peter can come forward. And Alicia can come forward. I'll request Pastor Benson to please come forward and hand over the gifts to them. First to Sean, Peter. May God bless you as you step into this new year. Amen. We'll pray over them as well. Praise God. I'll request Mahima to also come forward. We'll sing a song quickly for them and also end with a word of prayer. Yeah.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mahima. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Elisha. Happy birthday to you. Show. Happy birthday to you.
I am प्रार्थना करें स्वर्ग के पिता परमेश्वर हम आपको धन्यवाद देते प्रभु प्रभु ये तीनों बच्चों को आपके पवित्र हाथों में हम समर्पण करते प्रभु जी प्रभु तूने जो उनको जीवन दिया है खुदावन परमेश्वर प्रभु ये संसारिक जीवन में प्रभु उस अनंतता के जीवन की अनुभव में तू रखा है इसलिए हम आपको धन्यवाद देते परमेश्वर प्रभु जी वो मन फिराओ मैं प्रभु और प्रभु जी उस पवित्र आत्मा की भरपूरी में खुदाबंद परमेश्वर तेरी आज्ञाओं को मानते हुए इस साल परमेश्वर और भी आगे बढ़ने के लिए तू मदद कर परमेश्वर जो आत्मिक वरदाने इनके लिए आपने रखा है खुदाबंद परमेश्वर ये साल प्रभु जी उस आत्मिक वरदानों को प्राप्त करने वाले सालों में तू बदल दे परमेश्वर उनके एकेडमिक जर्नी में प्रभु जी वो फैमिली में रहते समय और उनकी पर्सनल लाइफ में खुदाबंद परमेश्वर आपकी उपस्थिति और आपकी सहभागिता आपका ग्रेस और आपकी मर्सीज हमेशा उनके साथ रहते हुए प्रभु जी आपके उस दर्शन में आगे बढ़ने के लिए तू मदद कर स्वर्गीय पिता धन्यवाद देते हैं सारी बातों के लिए तूने ये साल आशीषित करके ऑलरेडी दिया इसलिए धन्यवाद देते हैं परमेश्वर स्वर्गीय आशीषों में इन्हें तू ले चल यीशु मसीह के नाम से हम प्रार्थना मांगते हैं सुन और कबूल कर स्वर्गीय पिता आमेन आमेन गॉड ब्लेस यू प्रेज गॉड बस परमेश्वर हम स्वीट्स को भी परमेश्वर तेरे हाथों में देते हैं प्रभु इसके ऊपर में तेरे स्वर्गीय हाथ रहे आशीषित कर खुदाबंद परमेश्वर सैंक्टिफाई करके दे तेरी महिमा होने पाए यीशु के नाम से आमेन प्रेज़ जीसस